Well, I'm talking about impacting your world, and I hope you are following me. If you've missed out a few, maybe because of a whatever happened, maybe illness or what, you've missed the few weeks. I'm building up. I'm laying a foundation because this year is a year of build. And I really believe with all my heart that God wants to empower us to understand the kingdom dynamics, that you were not born again to go to heaven. You were born again to have influence on earth. Jesus came from heaven to earth to influence. And that is the mindset. We mustn't have this mindset that if I give my life to Christ, I'm going to heaven. Yes, you are, but it is a work to be done. We need to impact our world. We need to understand what it means to impact and how does I impact my world. The most important component of a church function is to empower you as a believer to be an agent of grace. That is the DNA of Jesus. I will show you this morning, we are so warped in our worldview, and we take this warped worldview and we bring it into our Christian walk, and we have all these compartments and all this do not and do and do not. Listen, in Christ, there's a fullness that we need to operate from to influence our world. So whatever happens in and through you will determine your effectiveness and your efficiency of engaging your world. If you do not allow God to work in and through you, your world will not be affected. Because God calls you light and salt. So you need to understand, family, what happens in you is the first priority in the kingdom. You invited Christ into your life. Now Christ is working from the inside out. The inside out. And that will determine your effectiveness, your engagement in your world. Your efficiency, how do you get into that space? Remember we talked about the framework of a disciple is to know God. And in knowing God, you know that's where you come from. That's your reference point. And because of that, there is identity that I'm a child of God. There's intimacy. He knows me and I can hear his voice. There's integrity. I can live in that space because Christ lives within me. And then we talked about loving people. Last week, we challenged one another to live beyond ourselves. But we said, it is mature Christians. It's the father that takes responsibility. We need to come from stage, the young man or the child, the young man and the father stage is that space that we can move in to live beyond ourselves. The mission that God has gave us. And this morning, I want to challenge you to engage you with the mission of Christ. Why did Jesus save you? Why did Jesus came to earth? It was to affect the world. And then we're going to flow just this morning. I want you just to put on your seatbelt and flow with me because I'm so excited what God is doing in and through our lives. So the first thing that God wants to do, he wants to bring a faithful presence. A faithful presence. Remember our first scripture that we read when Ephesians 1 verse 23 that said that God is in his church and he speaks in and through his church and his presence is with us. So if you believe that you are in Christ and Christ is in you, there is a presence. But this presence needs to be found in a faithful presence. What does a faithful presence mean? It means your lifestyle. You need to be faithful to the call of your lifestyle. Listen to what the Bible says in Matthew 10, 16. Listen carefully. I'm sending you. Say, God is sending me. Not to hell, eh? He's just sending you. God is sending me. And this is the Lord Jesus speaking to disciples. The guys that he picked out said, God, listen, follow me. I'll make you a fish of men. And he starts to form them with this faithful presence because he knows they're going to influence their world. And this morning you need to understand, God says, I'm sending you like a sheep among wolves. So be wise as a serpent and innocent as a dove, have no self-serving agenda. And when you read this, it's oxymoron. It doesn't make sense. Why doesn't God send us into this world as lions? And let them be the rock badgers or the world, let the world be the lambs, we are the wolves. But now Jesus says to his disciples, guys, I'm going to send you in this world, that scary place, as lambs among the wolves. It doesn't make sense. It feels the reference is not right. We want God to reset this and rewrite this. I say, God, can't we just be the wolves among the lambs? Because in that context, we feel like we have authority. We feel like we're in control. But we need to understand something about the kingdom. The kingdom works in opposite spirit. The kingdom has a different mindset. Listen to what Jesus says. When he empowers you in the kingdom way of living, love. You love where there's hatred. You love where there's hatred. There's forgiveness where there's bitterness. There's generosity where there's greed. There's humility where there's pride. There's the kingdom way of living. It's the opposite spirit. That's why the Bible says, go like lambs among the wolves. And you have this different spirit. When they shout at you hatred, you just forgive. When there's a greediness around you, you just generosity. But the problem is we engage our world in the flesh with three scriptures. We use the word as a weapon. We use the word as a whip to change our world. But let me tell you something. If you understand the presence of God is in you, the Bible says it's your presence. Is it His presence that changes us? And the presence of God's going to permeate through you, and that's going to change your world, family. We need to go into this world of opposite spirit. I think that's what Paul meant when Paul said, when I'm weak, I'm actually strong. I think that's the concept of the kingdom of God. It's not in the natural how strong I am. It's not how firm foundation I have. It's how weak I am in Christ so that His strength can come through me. It's the vulnerableness as man to say, Lord, here I am. But when I say something like influence your world, I know the first thought that comes to your mind is, what must I do? We see some kind of activity. We see something that we need to do, an action, a program we must follow, a tangible thing that I can say, well, this is what I did. But that's not what I'm talking about this morning. It's not something you have to go and do. It's something you need to be. Because you understand there's a faithful presence in your life, you will understand that your life sometimes is the only Bible that non-believer will see. You're the only Bible that someone will read. It's not about doing. It's not about going. It's not about, oh, I'll have to stand on a corner and shout. And no, it's about being that faithful presence in your world. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Sharing that little life, that little light you have, sharing that with your people, your lifestyle. Will become a fruitful or a faithful presence. You must manifest the faithful presence of Christ in your kingdom way of living in a daily basis. The other one is the fruitfulness. So the faithfulness is His presence. The fruitfulness is the kingdom culture. We bear a certain type of fruit. We're not bananas anymore. We are apples or pears or something. But there's a different fruit in the kingdom. And so when you understand that God has placed you as a lamb among the wolves, you need to understand that my fruitfulness will bring alignment to my world. I need to change my world to this kingdom way of living. Not the kingdom way of doing, the kingdom way of living. There's alignment that needs to take place to do things God's way. So when you see the fruitfulness in your world and you see there's a non-alignment, your world where you function, maybe at your workspace, maybe you're a teacher at school, wherever, and there's chaos, there's disorder, that alignment, what I'm talking about this morning, that you will ask yourself, what is the role that I can play to bring the kingdom culture into my world? What can I do? What can I play? How can I serve people? How can I be this light and salt that will cause a change and effect in my world? Because we want our world to change. We want our family to get born again. We want our work environment to be a place of love and care and joy and laughter. Amen? So I'm not talking about you getting into your space and say, listen, Tarzan has arrived. Right, me, Tarzan, you, Jane. No, I'm not talking about influencing your world with an attitude of power. We are servants of the Most High God. But it's recognizing as Christ's followers that we can and must change our world according to the kingdom dynamics. We need to understand that responsibility is upon us. Or else we're just going to live like day and day. If you look at the church, there's a great gap between our Sunday celebration and our Monday activity. Our Sunday faith and our Monday work ethics. There's a deep, big difference between that. So why is this important to have that fruitful presence? Because then you show the people what God has intended for their lives. When they look at you, I say, man, listen, being a Christian is awesome. People might speak behind your back, but what you have and how God blesses you and how you receive, they want to see. That is why God intended me to have. God wants me to have this. He wants me to have this lifestyle, the quality of life that's in Christ Jesus. We need to engage our world, family. But we need to do it the way Jesus did. Amen? Jesus did it a certain way. And that I want you to take responsibility this morning. Understand that is the way that Jesus brought his world into alignment to make this difference in his world. The Bible says, John 17:15, I do not ask you to take them out of this world, but that you will keep them to protect them from the evil one. So if you listen to the scripture and Jesus is trying to push our church into certain spaces and places, we need to understand, if you look at history, the church had four positions towards the world. And the first position, the posture that the church had towards the world was the protesting church. I remember when we just got born again many years ago, that was our mindset about church. We need to stand against. We need to push back. We had placards and we were walking the street against all this other stuff that's happening in our nation. But the position of the protesting church says we only show up when we don't agree what's happening in the world. There's stuff that they do that we don't agree with. So only time they see you is when you're angry with them. The only time they experience you when you feel like you're condemning them. The protesting church has no place. And we grew up in a society. I grew up in my Christian walk is I need to be against. All that's dark. I need to push back. But the problem is, if they only know you for what you're against, how do they know you for what you stand? And we stand for the good news. We confess the scripture that Christ has died for all and his desire that none should perish. But as a protesting church, we're in the spaces of our world saying they're wrong. You go to your family gathering and you are the protesting church. Stop smoking, stop drinking, you know, you're going to hell. That is not our place. That is not the way Jesus did it. I will show you. The other thing is this absent church. We see the world as bad as evil. There's a picture there, maybe you will recognize that church. They're against, it's like get out of the world. The world is dangerous. The greater distance between you and the world, the holier you are. Don't defile yourself. It's an absent church. We isolate ourselves, but here's the problem. If you are absent in society, if you are absent in your world, you become irrelevant. They don't miss you, family. Nobody is interested in what you have to give or to say because you're absent. And then we have this other church, the cultural church. And you see this a lot today in this year that we live in. The culture church is the church that engages its world, but it intermixes the culture of the world to the culture of the church. And instead of the church affecting their world, the world is affecting the church. And the church is not being light and salt and the influence that God has called us to be. But we will come just like the world and have no effect in our world. So what church that we want to be? What church do you want to be? And we want to be incarnational church. The church that Jesus talked about, that you're in this world, but you're not of this world. And because you're in this world, not of this world, your reference point is I need to affect my world as Jesus did. I love what the Bible says in the message. One is John 1:14 says, and the word became flesh and moved into our neighborhood. It just gives you a picture of what a church is supposed to be. The word became flesh and moved into our neighborhood. Have you ever moved into your neighborhood as this seeing church? We saw the glory of his with our own eyes, the one of a kind glory like the Father, the Son, generous inside and outside, true from the start to the finish. So how did Jesus do it? Yes, how Jesus manifested itself. Grace and truth. Listen, family, why is this important? Because you don't understand the concept of the kingdom. You will lead your world with truth. You will take the Bible and say, well, this is what our Bible says. This is what our Bible says. We say we are black and white people. We say we are people of truth. We are people of light. But if you see how Jesus engaged his world, is with grace first. Just think about the woman at the well in John 4. He didn't tell us, and I'm Jesus, I know all, and I'm telling you, you're sleeping around. He had grace. He said, if you ask me this water, I will give you this water. Define living water without talking about a background. But we enter our space with the truth. We want to tell people how wrong they are. We want to get into their face, man. We just want to turn upside down. And the way Jesus turned the tables upside down was by grace first. We need to learn by grace for how Jesus did it. It's always grace first, but in the right time, at the right space, introduce truth. So we lead by grace and we introduce truth. How many of you ever went into a space and you took the Bible as true and you tried to encounter someone, but there was no movement? Actually, you ended up in a fight. Actually, you ended up in a place that said, okay, whatever you believe, you believe. But I just want to tell you, you suck. That's how we did it in the beginning of our lives. We went into spaces and places and tell people how wrong they are. But the more you look like Jesus' life and the more you understand there's a faithful and a fruitful presence in you, the more engage your world like Jesus. I know they're wrong. I know they're on their way to hell. I can see it in their lifestyle. I can see it on the portraits on the walls. I can see it on their tattoos on their bodies. It doesn't matter. Grace. Grace. Grace is not a name of someone. But grace. And that person experienced that unconditional love, they will open to you. I mean, I've got a lot of friends that before they came to Christ, they were police people and they had some bad tattoos. And when I see them today, I smile at how they changed that tattoo. You know, it was a face of a dragon. Now they've tattooed like a face of an angel. Because we did stuff when we're in that space of our world. We want to live out, family. I want to tell you this morning, listen to what the Bible says. Matthew 5:13. And I took the Message because the Message is like, man, the Message is really, I'll slap you, Bible. If you read a Message, you get a slap. It just describes, and that's why in Afrikaans, many times when you read Afrikaans Bible, you need to get the boodskap or English Bible as well. Afrikaans is a very... It's a very poor language to understand the gospel precise. But listen what the Message says. Let me tell you why you are here. Just starts with this. Let me tell you. How many you really get upset when someone tells you? Let me tell you. Let me just tell you. Say, don't put your finger at me. Okay, I'll pull it. But let me tell you. I said, let me tell you why you're here. You are here to be the salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. Wow. You know, when I read it over and over and said, God, I can just see this picture, the salt seasoning that brings out the flavor of God on this earth. I love to cook, not to bake, but to cook. And it's all about the seasoning. It's all about the flavor. It's all about the aroma in the kitchen. And we've got my wife, actually Rachel and them. And so people visit our house and many times in the afternoon. And then they say, listen, you guys are killing us with this aroma, the fragrance, the smell. But that's how the Bible describes you. Let me tell you why you're here. There's an aroma in your life that you give off when you move people. You know, when you take all this, all the herbs, you can take it and you can smell it. But when you go like this, when you crash it a bit, it comes out. And that's why we need the world. You need your world just to rub you a bit the wrong way so that grace can come out at your life. Then he says this. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? You've lost your usefulness and you will end up in the garbage. Here's another way to put it. If you don't understand the first one, here's another one. You're here to be light. Bring out the God colors in this world. faithful presence, a fruitful presence in my world. I lead with grace. And then when the people are open to you, like the woman, and Jesus said, go call your husband. He said, I have no husband. He says, you're right, you've got five, and then six is also not yours. And he didn't push it away because grace filled that voidness of why she was at the well at 12 o'clock. Grace fills the voidness why people act out. And when that voidness is filled, the truth can just find its entrance. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. And we need to understand this is how God sees, but there's a worldview. In the world, there's a certain type of worldview, the way people think. In Africa, they have a saying, it takes a village to raise a child. That means the culture, the interaction, the value system of that society will develop this child. And it's still true today. The world has a pattern that it molds people into. And we're all like in this mold. And God says, I want to take you out. And you understand your world is a mess. Because they have a worldview that's warped. There's no place for God in that world. But you understand that you have Christ in you. And you understand they need it. They need it. So you have to go to that place to bring that influence. Listen to what the Bible says in Ephesians 2, 1 to 3 says, it wasn't long ago that you were mired in the old stagnant life of sin. You let the world, which does not know the first thing about living, tell you how to live. You filled your lungs with polluted unbelief and exhaled disobedience. Talking about us as church and as believers, the reference point from the world view that your world that's without Christ, they still live the same. They have a warped understanding about life and society. They are self-righteous. But Paul says to the church of Ephesus, listen, you also come from that space. That's why we have grace for people. Because we came from that reference point before serving Jesus Christ. We all did it. All of us doing whatever we like, whenever we felt like doing it. It's exactly, were you like that? Don't tell me what to do, but I'll do whatever I like. I can remember how many times I told to my parents. Even in our young marriage, I would tell it to my wife. And she says, okay, you do what you do, I'll do what I'll do. You have this, the worldview is warped outside. But God is on a route. He's doing us something within us. We felt like doing it. All of us in the same boat. Listen to Ephesians. This is amplified. And you had made alive when you were spiritually dead and separated from Him because of your transgressions and sin, in which you once walked. Why do I share this with you this morning? Because that's your world. I want you to understand your world because you come from that place. But when you're born again, you're born again from above. You have a different reference point. Christ, God, the Father, created heaven and earth, has created me. But He pushes you back into that world. We're not an absent church that brings separation between the world and us. We're not a protesting church telling people how wrong they are and we never show up with the good news of Christ. We're not a culture church that gets involved in that warp society and we try to find Christ in the cracks. We're the incarnational church, understanding that we're in this world, but we're not of this world. You are following the ways of the world, influenced by the present age. In accordance with the prince of the power of air, the Satan, the spirit is now at work in the disobedient, the unbelieving, who fight against the purposes of God. Among these unbelievers, we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, our behavior governed by the sinful self. So, Pastor, what are you doing? I'm telling you, that's your world. That's why they live how they live, because Satan is influencing them. They've got a different worldview about life. There's many people that say, when you die, you die. They don't live. They don't believe there's an eternity. But we know, we understand. Indulging in desires of human nature without the Holy Spirit and the impulses of the sinful mind. We were, by nature, children under the sentence of God's wrath, just like the rest of mankind. Think about life. and how we can affect that worldview. How can we determine the value of the kingdom and bring it to our world in such a way that they can understand what God wants from them? Because if you have this saying that it takes a village to raise a child, I want to ask you, who's raising the village? In society, if we have this product, the byproduct of divorces and all that stuff, who's raising the village? Who's the standard givers? Who's the measure? How full is that bucket? We need to understand. See, because God's got something to say about this challenge of the value system of our worlds and the world we are in. And that's the word repentance. So when we tell people to repent, we need to understand it's not to say sorry for their sins only. Repentance is the word metanoia. Metanoia means to change your mind. Meta mind, noia, nous mind. Change your mind. So when you say to someone, need to repent, it says change your mind about Jesus. Change your mind about the gospel. Not saying you're sorry, you're going to hell. So we need to understand this, family, that repentance is not just saying sorry. Repentance is about starting to think in a different way. So this morning, as I'm preaching, I hope there's repentance by you and say, God, I had a whop idea about church. I was a protesting person in my family. They knew that I'm against, but not what I'm for. But when there's family gatherings, we didn't pish up because they are worldly. We know they're going to drink and they're going to swear and they're going to fight. So we just don't pitch. Or we get so involved after a few beers that we're just like them. But yes, the key, that when we sit down with people, we talk about repentance. It's not about their sin only. It's about to change their mind on what Jesus is and the way Jesus. And that's what happened to us when we got repented. The name Jesus became this beautiful name. It was a cuss word when you were not saved, but when you saved, it was a word that meant so much deep stuff in your life. We need to start thinking different. This is what Paul speaks to the Colossian church. He says, so see to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human traditions, according to elemental spirit of the world, and not according to Christ. See, there's a worldview out there that try to influence the church. But because we know who we are, we can bring our faithful and our fruitful presence, because Christ is within us, into our world, leading with grace, sharing truth in such a manner that they will repent and join you as well. Join, that's what the Bible says. Look for the man of peace. The man of peace is a guy that's been through the wars and say, I don't know what, I've been fighting this all my life and it doesn't make sense. What can I do? Help me. And that's that person you engage. That's what Romans 12:2 says. And do not be conformed to this world any longer with the superficial values and customs. Doesn't it describe the world at this moment? How superficial life is around us? But be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values, ethical attitudes. Wow. Kingdom living. Godly values, ethical attitudes. That you may prove for yourself what the will of God is, which is good, acceptable, and perfect in His plan and purpose for you. Do not be conformed. Do not be pushed into this pattern of this world, but be renewed in your mind. That's why it's so important to wash yourself with the Word of God, to be in fellowship with other Christians and believers, to evaluate your life and say, am I still in this faith? Or has the culture, this warped worldview, especially if you work with people, you know, my heart goes out for people that works in the office space. I remember my wife when she worked at a city council, she worked at a certain department. And when I pick her up after work, many times she was in tears about what happens in that space. The gossip, the slander, the works, especially on a Monday morning when they give you feedback about their lives on a weekend. I can say this with great boldness. I think men sometimes is worse than ladies. And I see all the ladies go, yeah, yeah. Let me try the different. I know that women is worse than men. And I see all the men go, yeah. But that is the thing. That's what's happening around us. And they're pushing us into this pattern. But the world says, be transformed by them. What's this? Why? Because there's essence with Christianity. We ought to demonstrate that we are transformed humans. We're not scary people. We are transformed humans. I'm just like you, but I'm transformed in my understanding what life is all about. I'm still flesh and blood. I still feel pain. I still get hurt when you speak down on me, but I understand I'm a transformed human. I can turn the other cheek. I can walk the second mile. I can love you. Where there's hate, I have love. Where there's greed, there's generosity. Where there's pride, there's humility. That opposite spirit, we walk in that opposite spirit because we understand that's what Christianity is all about. To bring distraction to this worldview, but also to construct the kingdom understanding. So whatever you break down in your world, you need to build up again. Don't leave voidness. Don't tell the world what this is, because Christianity is a life system. It's a life structure. The kingdom of God is a system. Bible says, whatever you sow, you will reap. It is a system. We act, if the kingdom of God is not a system, it's not a structure, and we act out of character, and then want to reap in character. It is so. That's what the Bible says. Do not mock God for whatsoever. Because everything existed and came into being because Christ demands it. Christ is the one that created everything. Satan came and warped it. We saw it in an incident in the Garden of Eden. There were peace, there were unity, they were flowing. And then there's a bendedness that took place. All of a sudden, you have this husband and wife that are separation. And Adam says to God, this is the wife you gave me. She forced me to eat the apple. And sin just crept in, and the two brothers, one killed the other brother. And we just see this society that was born out of sin. And still today, the worldview is exactly the same. Their reference point is self-righteousness. It's my car, I can do what I want. It's my house, it's my life, and I can drive like I want. I mean, we see it every day. But therefore, they need to be subject to Him first, because God had a purpose and a meaning when He created humanity. When He created the earth, there was a purpose and a plan. Let me tell you, the Bible is not a motivational book. The Bible for our Christians is the blueprint for Christian living. It's not a motivational book. We must stop having pet scriptures. We live like the world, we get warped views, and when we're in trouble, we confess, whatever shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And we have this Christianese voice. Get behind me, Satan. Jesus' name. And then I just draw back and say, God, what are we doing? That's why Paul said to Peter, you hypocrite, man. You just had lunch with us now, and all of a sudden your Jewish friends come, and you stand up and you're not sitting with us anymore. You're warped in your mind. You hypocrite, you're not constant in your walk. And to impact our world, we need to be constant in His faithful and fruitful presence, leading by grace. Knowing where we come from is a wicked place, but we have our light and we are salt, and we need to release a flavor of God in people's lives. Amen. Listen to what the Bible says, John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word was God, and the Word was God. That word means logos in Greek, and what it actually means is the rational pattern of creation, the order of the universe. In the beginning was the order of the universe. In the beginning was the rational pattern of creation. In the beginning, that's how God intended it to be. That was the framework that Jesus said, this is supposed how it functioned. Everything needs to be interpreted and understood in this framework in the beginning. Let me read you a scripture, Colossians 1, 16 and 17. For by Him all things, say all things. I want you to see how many times all things is there. By Him, that is God. All things were created in heaven and on earth, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, rules, authorities, all things were created and existed through Him. That is, by His activity and for Him. And He Himself existed and is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. He is the controlling, cohesive force behind the universe. all things, family, impact your world. Look at the churches in the 1800s. We all look at the guys like Swift, Will Swift, John G. Lake, and Charles Finney and those guys. But I don't want to say the true church, but let's say the undefiled churches before humanism got involved. When the church was, there was life. The church built orphanages, hospitals, schools. That's why some denominations still has it. They have their own schools and their own hospitals and stuff. But that was the life of the church. When a church moved into an unsafe population, their life came. They became orphans. They had fathers and the sick had hospitals and stuff happened. But now these days, we lost our influence. But can I say something to you? The problem is not the lack of Christians that has influence in your world, in your workspace. That's not a problem. The problem is we don't know how to engage and to release those influence. We are in a place of influence. You might be head of a department. But because we have this mindset from my religion and my activities at work are far apart, we don't use that space of influence. If you look at the life of Paul, wherever he was, in the synagogue or with the disciples, he used his influence to influence the society. If you look at the disciples when they were sent out, Thomas the doubter, the one that said, if I don't put my hands in the wounds, I won't believe you. He went to India and he was filleted for the gospel. That means he was skin alive, not renouncing Jesus. Because something happened in his life. There was a fragrance that came forth. We need to learn, family, Sunday faith, to connect Sunday's faith to Monday's lifestyle. Because you all look good this morning. You smell good, you look good. And you came prepared this morning because you came to church. But what about Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday? How far is your apart from that real life that God has called you to be? Because he has the truth. This study was made by Barnard Studies, and they said, Christians, can cut them up in three sections. The first section, 34% of Christian believers, this is born again believers, this is churchgoers. It's not your guy in the corner, it's the churchgoers. 43% of the churchgoers compartmentalize, if there's a word like this, that has a clear separation of their faith and work. They do not see connection. If you tell them, listen, what God has done for you on Sunday, take it to work on Monday. They cannot, cannot see the connection between their spirituality and their workplace. So will never impact their world. There will never be a faithful release of the presence and the fruitful presence of Christ in the workspace. 38% are onlookers. These are people that recognize the need to be connected between their faith and their work, but they're passive. They are positioned. They see what's going on in society. They see the corruption. They see the understreaming, but they're just passive. It's not my problem. You see it in society. You can drive past and you'll see two guys fighting. No one stops. It's not your problem. That's how we be conducive. That's how we start functioning. I'm in that same space. Sometimes my wife said to me, listen, we need to be that. And I said to her, it's not my problem. Then she told me, okay, you're a pastor only on Sundays. Say, no, but I look better on Sundays. But that's the problem we have, family. We're in a place of influence, but we're passive because we have this mindset that Sundays is for Jesus. I mean, I cannot tell how many times we went on holiday and then stuff will happen in this space. And my wife would say, you need to reach out to that people. You saw how they talked and what they did. Then I said, for crying out loud, baby, I'm on holiday. So that means you're not a Christian when you're on holiday? You're not the cold one? You don't have the fragrance of Christ? Did you switch it off now? And it speaks to me. And then we eventually engage that people because we have a fruitful and a faithful presence of Christ in me. That's what I'm talking about. If you really want to impact your world, you need to be constant. You really need to be constant, family. But there's that 28%. They can integrate their faith with their work. This connecting faith and work. Only 28%. That means if there's 100 people in this house this morning, 28 understand that I can impact my world. Only 28 people that has the mindset, whatever God does to me on a Sunday, whatever I experience of the Lord during the week in my private time, I need to take it to my world. I need to be influence and difference in my workspace. So I want to challenge you, family. Are you going to impact your world? Are you going to be that faithful and fruitful presence? Are you going to come to that space where you can meet with grace and at the right time introduce truth? Do you understand that the world outside is warped and bended? Does it help us looking down on the crowd? Get involved in the crowd, but be light and be salt. Don't worry, you will not be defiled. I'm going to tell you, sometimes I think when I by myself, I said, when Jesus comes, he's not going to come to the church first. He's going to go to the marketplace. And help us to find us in that space, impacting our world. Jesus said, I did not come for the sick, for the healed. I came for the sick. So I want to ask you this morning, can you impact your world? Will you walk the reconciliation? Give me that last slide. Can you this morning put your faith and your work? Can you see the connection? Why God saved you? What is His purpose and plan for your life? Why do you call Him Father? What does the sons do? The sons work in the vineyard. The Father created the capacity to do it. He brings the resources to town. It's the Father that buys the tractors and all the seeds and all the compost, the manure for the farm. But it's the boys that's planting. It's the boys. So we have children. You don't need any resources. God is able to do it. If you understand that inside of you, there's a fragrance that God needs to release into your world. And I want to tell you, I believe with all my heart, your family spaces, your gatherings, eventually, if you live this lifestyle, will change. Eventually, if you become that constant in that space, leading by grace, right time, one-on-one truth, then we'll be glad. You'll be first on the invitation list. Listen, we're having a bride. Will you come? Will you come? So my question this morning, are you going to impact your world? Are we going to be that separation, protesting culture, or are you going to be the incarnational church, understanding Christ that sent you? He sent you to that space because He knows He's in you, and therefore you don't need to fear. Don't need to have the anxiety. Everything you need is inside of you. We must stop looking for the outside encounters and just release what's in us, the presence of God. Light and salt. Light and salt. You know, light is something that we all need. If you walk into a dark room, the first thing you need is light. And if you invade your space and they dark, they need you. They need you. They might be like Nicodemus, religious, but they're going to ask you the question, how do I going to do this? How do I going to resolve this issue in my life? But the question is, do you believe this morning that you are able to impact your world? Not because you're going to do much, do stuff. Not challenging you to do stuff. I'm challenging you to be the church. Be the bearers of the presence of God in your life. Let your eyes be the windows of your soul. When people look into your eyes, let them see the softness of the lamb. Even if they're wolves, even if they growl for you, even if they want to devour you, let him see the softness of the lamb in your eyes. Amen. Praise God. Will you give God praise for the church, for the word?